So would you like to introduce yourself and say who you are and what your creative art form is?
Yeah, my name is Kevin Butcher. I'm based in Middlesbrough and I'm a writer, mainly poetry and short stories. Do you want me to talk a bit about my background or what I've done? Or
yeah, you can. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I studied contemporary fine art, so I guess I've always been creative. I've always made, you know, physical, visual arts. Always written stories and poetry, and I guess I thought, well, I'm going to go down the art route. So I went to Leeds Met, then transferred to Sheffield Hallam, did my art degree. Then I had a couple of years where I was doing other things. So I did a photography course, I did dressmaking. Then I went and did science and maths, strangely, and that's why I'm working in the labs now. And then I went back and did my master's in creative writing because I realised that's where I was most comfortable, really, where my passion was. And I guess through studying that, introduced me to poetry, because poetry, I mean, it's always something I've enjoyed reading. Never considered myself a poet. I used to cringe with a lot of the stuff I'd actually written when I was younger. But I suppose it's quite nice to read over it now and think, what was I on about? Maybe that's something I can, you know, re-edit and work with. And I guess just, there was kind of just a direction I was following. I did my dissertation, main piece of work on poetry, looking at therapeutic writing and creative language and artistic influence over poetry. And I guess I've just continued doing that since uni, really. Trying to fit it into finding time with day jobs to try and be creative and switch from science to art. But yeah, that's my story, really.
Wow, that's varied, isn't it?
Yeah.
But they do say that science, maths and creativity kind of go together anyway, don't they?
Definitely.
So when did you first get involved in poetry? When and how? Was it through the creative writing course?
I guess it was. I mean, because I did it with you, didn't I? So I was
you on did, the yeah.
with you. And I remember saying at the time when Bob had said we have to perform it, and I was like, I can't, there's no way I can do it. And I was horrified and the whole thing, you know, I was up on stage thinking, what am I talking about? What am I doing? But then as soon as I sat down, I thought, actually, I really enjoyed that. And it's an odd thing because I think about reading poetry or performing poetry, it's very unnatural for me to do. And when I'm about to go up and do it, I'm thinking, crap, should I just run out the door and not do it? Then I get up there and I'm thinking, are people hearing what I'm actually saying? Is the right thing coming out? And then as soon as I sit down, I'm like, oh yeah, that was actually pretty amazing and I want to do that again. So it's probably because I wouldn't say I'm the most confident person, but I think those kind of environments probably push you to do something out of your comfort zone, and I think that's a really important thing. And which is why I do continue to go to the poetry and spoken word events, because as much as it's painful, it's actually therapeutic in its own way, and it makes you realise, oh, I can do it, I can be like the other people reading.
Yeah.
I'm not that out of touch with it, so.
Yeah, I agree. And there's always somebody who connects to what you're saying, isn't there?
Definitely.
And how you say it, because you're unique in how you
say your,
And
I think that, you know, I think we're all our own worst enemies and our own critics, aren't we? So I think it's natural to think, oh, it's not good enough, it's not on the same level as other people. But I've noticed at a few events, it is nice when people come up to you at the end and they'll say, I actually really understood what you're trying to say and I really enjoyed the language you used. And then, not that you do it for the compliments, but it's nice to think, well, as much as I'm writing for myself, it's nice to think that my words actually mean something to somebody else, and it maybe, you know, awake something what they think, I feel that way, and this person's somehow managed to go through that journey and explore it, write about it at the end. So hopefully would inspire other people to sit down and write or create a visual art and do a painting or anything, really.
I think
it's important for everyone to have that creative release. And it's something that, you know, day to day living, you don't really set that time aside. You just think, you know, I don't have time to do that. Other people, that's their life, but it's not mine. But I think it's so important to have that balance and to really just to understand yourself and have that conversation with yourself and think, oh yeah, there's that little thing that's buried away somewhere that I'm going to get out on the page. And that's lovely in its own way.
Mm. Yeah, it is. It is. What inspired you to get involved?
I guess.
What inspired you to go on the creative writing course, which meant you ended up as a poet?
You know, to be honest, Julie, I remember going to the open day at Teesside Uni, and I actually went and I talked to the art tutor because I was thinking, I want to do my master's, but it was, shall I do art? Shall I go and do writing? And because I didn't have my degree in creative writing, as much as I spent probably 2 years on the art course doing writing, which kind of confused a lot of my tutors thinking, why you're on a, you know, visual arts degree if you want to write. I guess I realised that talking to tutors and looking at the work, I was thinking, actually, I really want to, just, I want to write. That's what I want to do. And I feel like if I did the fine art degree, I would have ended up wanting to meet with the creative writing tutors or go down that path. Not that it's, I'm not saying it's necessarily a separate thing, because, you know, it's nice to combine the two. And I remember meeting with Chris, the former lead of the course, and I said, you know, I still want to do my paintings, and I want to do visual things and design clothing and make that, and as well as do the writing. And he was actually actively encouraging that, saying, like, it's, you know, I think it's important that you try and do both, and maybe, you know, your paintings are visual representations of what your words are.
Yeah.
And I guess that what inspired me to do it is just that it was an idea of setting aside that time. And I don't think you, as much as, you know, you do set up maybe 10 minutes a day or an hour a day, however long you choose to write. And I think having deadlines and being around other people and having that support network and being in a community, I think that's just quite inspiring in itself. And I think that pushes you.
Yeah.
Probably just keep working on your craft and really getting out there and getting your voice out there. And I guess it's just always something I've considered myself to be, or, you know, you always have that thing on, deep down, I'm meant to be a writer or an artist.
Yeah.
And I guess that doing the degree was a way for me to kind of think, I did have that in me, it is there. And then obviously with the poetry and the spoken word events, I thought, I've just got to push myself and do it, really, and then learn from it. And it's quite a nice inspirational setting to see diversity and to see so many different creative people coming together.
It's a great community. We've got a great community in Teesside, haven't we?
Yeah,
I think we're really lucky. What are your major influences and inspirations?
I guess with the art side, it was always like surrealism and Dada. That was always what I was like drawn to when I was younger, really. Things that are a bit odd. With the writing, I guess I love beat literature. So for me, I remember reading it when I was very young, A Naked Lunch by Burroughs. That was like a major thing for me, because if I was ever having days where I thought I feel blocked, it sounds strange, but I'd read a couple of pages and think, right, I know what I'm doing now, and it just go off and just do something. I love Ginsberg, I love Ferlinghetti. More recently, I love Salima Hill. I think she's amazing, and Vicky Feather, Elizabeth Jacobson. There's just so many amazing poets. I love reading anthologies, and it's just, you know, introducing you to so many new names and new styles. And I guess just continuing to read, and there's, you know, that's a nice thing, I think, just always finding new names. I mean, when I was growing up, I loved Catcher in the Rye. I thought that was just, I don't know, you know, it's going to speak to you weirdly. I thought, oh, I don't know, it's a teenage boy. I thought, like, I don't know, there's just something in that the way he kind of narrated it. That's a massive influence. And then I suppose, like, existential literature, like Sartre's Nausea, I loved that growing up as well. So there's a bit of a range, really.
Yeah, that's a really wide range, really. Yeah, that's great. Do you work alone? You work alone, don't you, Kelly? Have you ever collaborated?
Not with writing. I haven't with writing. I did, obviously with my degree, I did it some group work. I've done video collaborations and such, but I've never actually collaborated with my poetry or writing. It's not something I'm you know, adverse to doing. It's just, I guess I've never pushed myself to do that. I've always been a bit of a loner, and I always tend to just lock myself away.
Yeah.
I'm quite reluctant with sharing. I always think it has to be 85% perfect before I'll even consider let someone read it. So I think that's probably why I've never really pushed myself to work with people.
Yeah, I think most people, most writers feel like that, actually. It's, it's quite hard, isn't it, to share what you feels like.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah. But collaborations, would you be interested in collaborating in the future?
Yeah, definitely. I think as I've got older and I've got a bit more experience with that, I've realised, you know, it's people want to read and work with you because they don't know, they want to help you in ways, don't they? They want to support you, whereas I was not, you know, it's very much because it is a kind of therapy for me, you know, so it's just something I do behind closed doors by candlelight and I don't show it to anybody else. But I feel, you know, it's probably just as that kind of enriching in a way to kind of push yourself and work with somebody else and swap ideas.
I agree, Where, is there anywhere we can find your work? Have you had any poems published in any anthologies or...?
I've got one coming out recently in an anthology called Rebloom. It's kind of like looking at, like, from a woman's point of view and women's issues, and that's coming out at the end of this month, actually. And I'm currently just working, trying to actually write some more short stories and hopefully try and get them out there as well.
Yeah, do you submit much?
I'm quite lazy with it, I'm not going to lie. I have, the last year, I'd say I've been pushing it more and trying to get out there because I know nobody does like the rejection, and I feel like a few rejections, you're like, I'm terrible, there's no point, I'm not going to do it. But then I guess the more you do it, you think, I'm actually not bothered if you don't like it. But when you do eventually get something accepted, it makes you feel like, oh, you know, it's not that bad, maybe.
I think when you first start submitting and you start getting them and you get rejections, which obviously everybody gets, I think they feel really personal at first. But I think the more you do it, the less personal they feel. And they,
definitely, and
they,
they
become easier to accept those rejections. So
and I think
keep doing it.
And there's just so many amazing writers out there, isn't there? And I guess these publishers get thousands of applicants every day. At the time it feels like a dagger through the heart, but I suppose
why don't you like my poem? Keep doing it. So why are the creative arts important to you, Kelly, personally and generally?
I guess it, as I mentioned before, it's just, I think that everyone should have a creative release, everyone should have that. And for me, it's something I've always done since I was a kid. My mum's always encouraged me, and we've always done painting or writing together. So I guess if I didn't have that, I think I'd probably be less healthy in a way, mentally and physically, because I need to have that kind of therapeutic release. And I think that's important for me, but I also think for other people, just, you know, to have that break from reality in a way and just, like, have that alternative thought and just to be able to go off and, you know, mess up a bit of canvas or just write some rubbish on a page. And it might not necessarily mean anything to anybody else, but I think for that person doing it, and you just have that time to kind of rejig in a sense and have that release. And I think that's very important. And I don't think that a lot of people do set aside that time for themselves because of being caught, and especially with what's going on in the world now, it just feels like things have been pushed back a bit. But yeah, I just think it's just very important to be creative, I suppose, and have that conversation with yourself and connect with yourself and connect with your environment and other people.
Yeah, absolutely. How's lockdown been?
Sure, it's obviously it's awful, but I just think I've been so busy.
I suppose for you it's kind of not really been any different then.
No, I mean, I've probably been busier than normal anywhere. And sometimes I'm doing things and I'm thinking, oh, I'll do this and that. Obviously, we can't know because of lockdown. But then I turn on the news and I'm like, oh God, yeah, COVID's happening. And sometimes I just forget. And that sounds awful in a way. But I think because I go to work and I've got my own routine, and then it doesn't feel that different other than I can't go to the pub or I can't go to the cinema. Yeah. Or something. So as much as it's been quite scary, like my anxiety is probably worse this year because I think a lot of people's like health anxiety has kicked up as well. And I know any little ailment, any little kind of tickle in your throat or headache, you're thinking, oh, is it COVID? Should I be going outside? Should I be seeing people? And yeah, it's just it's very, very odd, year, isn't it?
Yeah. Oh well, I think that's quite healthy actually. That you know, you go into work and when you switch on the news, you kind of are reminded about it. That's really good because you know, if you're too focused on it, I think it can just drive you mad.
Yeah.
So yeah, that's a really healthy way to be going through it, Kelly. Yeah. You know what I mean? So yeah. Anyway, thank you so much.
Yeah, no problem.
Thank you. That was lovely. Really nice interview. Really lovely.
Oh.
So hopefully 2021, we'll see you back at some poetry night, yeah?
When
life gets back to some kind of normality, hopefully, fingers crossed. Yeah?
All this desperate for some social interaction, aren't we?
Oh, I know. My God, I can't believe how long it's been. It's just, I know. Just can't wait to...
24-hour
poetry event, won't we? That's a really, do you know what, that's it, we're going to do it at Shanty, 24-hour, oh my God, what a great idea, that's fantastic, thank you for that.
No problem.
So you'll have to come and do it.
I will.
Enjoy the rest of your day and have a great Christmas.
Yeah, you too.
Yeah, see you next year sometime. All right, thank you so much, Kelly.
Bye.
Okay, bye.